God, maker of heaven and earth, we thank you for the truth of your word, Jesus Christ, that shines light into our darkness, that gives peace in the midst of our brokenness. We ask that by the power of your Spirit, we might have understanding of this one true word, and it might transform our lives. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to start with a question today. Raise your hand if you own a home. Good for you. Now raise your hand if you pay rent. Right. My wife, Becky, and I have been renters for all 10 years of our marriage. And we are growing envious of you homeowners. We don't care how much property taxes are in New Jersey. We just want a home. We want to paint our walls whatever color we want. We want a fence around our property, and we want a dog that can just run all over our yard and protect it. We want a big yard so we don't have to keep bringing our kids to the playground down the street. We want a place to call our own. You know, the United States Declaration of Independence declares that God has given each of us a right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But if you study the history of that phrase, you learn that philosophers used to say it differently. That we each have a right to life, liberty, and property. And in American culture, there is a deep relationship between happiness and owning property. But you know, property is so important to us because we are insecure creatures. Every day we go out into the world and we feel pushed around and threatened. You can get bullied at school. You can get battered and discouraged at work. Some here may experience being pushed out of their homeland. We are insecure creatures. And it means so much and it feels so good to have a home, a place that you can call your own, a place where no one can touch you, a place where you are safe and secure. So we all naturally desire to possess property, to have a secure place of our own, but here's the problem. There are a lot of people on this earth. It's kind of like this church. There are now at least five groups, I think, sharing the same space. And this building is not getting any bigger. That parking lot is definitely not getting any bigger. We live in a crowded world. I recently heard that there are now over 25 megacities in our world. 25 megacities. And those are cities whose population exceeds 10 million people. The questions that will continue to define our conversations, our political conversations, our global conversations, will be questions about space, about security, and borders. That's the world we live in. And do you know what happens when our very normal human desire to possess property, to have a place all of our own, to be safe and secure. You know what happens to that desire when it finds itself in a crowd with people all around pressing in? Often, that desire starts to dig its feet in. It's going to hold its ground. It's not going to be pushed around. It can even turn hostile towards its neighbors. Jesus tells us a story about that. And it might sound like an outrageous parable. There's these tenants, these renters, who work in the owner's vineyard. And they kill the owner's servants who come to collect the fruits of the harvest. So then the owner sends his very own son. But instead of respecting the owner's son, the tenants throw him out of the vineyard and kill him. But I don't think this is outrageous behavior, only because it's very human behavior. Those tenants were probably like migrant farmers. Life had probably pushed them around. They were insecure people. Like us, they desired a place to call their own. And now they had worked in this land for years. They had been the ones working the ground. They kind of had a relationship to it. It was theirs. The owner had gone off to another country, and all of a sudden he wants to send people back to collect the fruits. No. This was their chance to finally seize some property for themselves, to finally have some property of their own in this life. So they dig their feet in. They hold their ground. And they greet these visitors, not with hospitality, but with hostility. This is not outrageous behavior. It is very human behavior. And it's even the story of us, of God's people. In the prophet Isaiah, God declares to the people, I gave you this promised land, this vineyard, this place to work and flourish. But what has come of it? The Lord God says, I expected justice, but I saw bloodshed. I expected righteousness, but heard cry. We all live and work in a crowded world. We worship in a crowded church. We are all insecure creatures, and we all desire to be safe and secure. So what will God then see in our neighborhoods? Will our neighbors be crying out for hunger and cold? Will we greet our neighbors with hospitality or hostility? Will we defend our space or make space for one another? The gospel is God's declaration of independence. And in Jesus Christ, we are told, we are all given a right to life, to liberty, but before property, and even before the pursuit of happiness, we all have a right to peace. Peace comes before property. I was doing some reading on this, and I discovered that in Scripture, the right to own property is not absolute. In the book of Leviticus, chapter 25, verse 23, God speaks to Moses about this promised land. God says this, the land must not be sold permanently, for the land belongs to me. And you, people of God, you are only foreigners, my tenant farmers. You can only rent in God's kingdom. You can only rent in God's kingdom. And listen, I want to be a tenant. I want to be a renter in God's kingdom. And I hope you do too. But if that's the case, then we need to know the price of rent. James 3:18 tells us, a harvest of justice is sown in peace. Peacemaking is the price of rent in God's kingdom. Scripture invites us to see God as our landlord. And in this rental agreement, this covenant of grace we enter into with God, God freely gives us so many gifts and blessings, but we are called to pursue peace. That's sometimes hard for us. Sometimes we pray and relate to God as if we are the only tenants, as if we're the only ones around. We are so focused on whether God is blessing me, on whether God will help me get way we like it. And on this World Communion Sunday, let us be reminded that God is not only our individual landlord, but God is also a community developer. And God's vision is to develop and create a world where everyone has space to flourish. That might sound impossible, for our world is far from it. But God is calling each of us, and all of us, every tenant here, to make peace a priority. And what does that mean? It means at times that you are willing to give up some of your possessions so others can be provided for. It means you welcome visitors and foreigners. It means you are gentle in your dealings with one another. But it takes something to pursue peace, given all of our insecurities. It requires that we trust our landlord. We trust our landlord. We become most possessive when we're afraid. When we're afraid that our basic needs, those things we long for, won't be met. I remember Becky and I, we had very serious doubts about whether we could trust our first landlord. We had serious doubts that she was not fulfilling her part of the rental agreement. For example, there didn't seem to be enough electricity coming to our apartment, because in order to use our microwave, we had to unplug the refrigerator and turn off all the lights in the apartment just to heat up a hot dog for 20 seconds. Renting from that landlord literally left us in the dark. I don't want to live in the dark. But the landlord of heaven and earth is someone we can trust. Someone we can trust. And we know that by looking at Jesus. Jesus pursued peace over property. He had no place to lay his head, but he shared his bread. And even though he was met with hostility and his life was taken, God was a faithful landlord. He raised him up and welcomed him back with hospitality into his own fellowship. And this is God's promise to peacemakers. I will raise you up. I will raise you up. God will not leave us in the dark and the cold, but will bring us into the light and warmth of community. And why is this? This is because even though God is the owner of all of heaven and earth, everything we see belongs to God. God's greatest possession, God's treasured possession, is you and I. You know, sometimes when our possessions or property gets badly damaged or broken, we just say, that's beyond repair. And we just leave it, we throw it in the trash or abandon it. We give up on it. Not so with God. God deals with his treasured possession with gentleness. So God always takes the time to bend down and prepare us this treasured possession and restore us to that place of honor. So, beloved of God, remember that this earth we all live on, this crowded space, is one great rental property. So don't hold too tightly to your belongings, but be ready to share. Be ready to pursue peace. Trust that the same God who gave us the many blessings of this world is preparing a home with enough room and space for each one of us. In the name of the one God, Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen.